Hello everybody, and welcome to part 5 of my Grisaille painting tutorial. We're about to finish this phase of the project, and appropriately, I want to start this conversation by talking about one of my favorite... subjects for students, and that is, what does it take to get this stuff done? What does it take to learn these concepts and learn to apply them? Certainly, talent is important, skill is important, having the right materials in the right studio space, all these things are important. But all of them together, without tenacity, that innately human quality that combines willpower and stamina, is the final ingredient that I think is so important. When I was a student, most of my projects that failed would fail because I didn't follow through. So back then, I started the long journey on the way to trying to understand why that was. What is it that I could do, and how could I alter my process to give myself the best opportunity to see a project through to the end? Eventually, that goal is going to be different for every single one of us. I'll tell you what worked for me though. I found that I needed to focus on very basic and simple accountable goals at every stage of the painting. This is really the primary reason why I take my tutorials and separate them into different videos. Each stage should feel like a kind of accomplishment. But in order to do that, we need to have clearly set goals for each moment of the painting. This is why the assignments that I give you at every phase, I think, are so useful. If we need to reblock in the painting, let's focus on that. Let's experience success in our block-in. Then that prepares us to open a new chapter that we can also progress through in a reasonable amount of time, where we can also experience a little taste of accomplishment and success. So as we enter into part 5 of this lesson, where our painting day will be a continuation of our previous painting day, meaning there was not drawing time in between, let's focus at every stage we can on some distinct and accountable change that we want to make to our painting that will level us up, get us to a new plateau that will serve as the basis for the completion of the painting. So the state of the painting in the place that this video tutorial is starting out is unlike what it is in most of my tutorials. The painting hasn't dried in between videos, and this one is just a continuation of the window of drying time that we started at the beginning of the previous video. So that means no oiling out, no re-blocking in, and what we can do is essentially continue the refinements and adjustments that we started on at the beginning of the previous video. So let's take a look at the canvas and see where we're going from here. For starters, we have established really, really well the highest key planes. And because of that, a lot of the subsequent values, the dark halftone values that are leading towards the shadow, are looking to be in pretty good shape. However, there are a few problem areas that are definitely going to need my attention in this second session. Looking at the light shape of the neck, it's not surprising to find that there's been a little bit less attention down here than there has been in the portrait. I also can make the same observation about the ear, and also a little bit the hair up here, which is somewhat uncomfortably close to the focal area to be so far behind. So a lot of my attention is going to go there today. Some things that are working so far are the transitions and forms in the lower half of the face. I would say the gradation of value here is really well chosen, creates a strong sense of form leading from the light to the shadow, and in a general sense, does what it needs to do. In addition, areas like this, where we have some really beautiful dark halftones that are leading into this vague area here, which is a little bit shadow, a little bit dark halftone. And that being the case, it is painted so far, and being ambiguous in that particular way, we've painted it ambiguously, which is exactly what we're looking for. You can see also just how dark the shadows have become. Areas like this and this, earlier on in the painting, took on a quite lighter personality, and here they've been keyed down quite dramatically in relationship to some of the lighter values. Even in comparison to some of the darkest halftones, these two areas drop away immensely. There's a rule that's often talked about that the lightest shadow should be darker than the darkest halftone, and I usually shy away from using that as kind of a catch-all advice because it relates only very specifically to lighting situations like the one we're working in here. So in a primary dominant light source situation, you can kind of rely on this idea that the lightest shadows will be darker than the darkest halftones. But bear in mind, if you're in a studio with a lot of different light sources, that is going to change dramatically. Stopping briefly in this moment to take a look at our painting and assess where we're at, Even though we have this improvised mahl stick sitting here in the middle of the painting, I want to revisit some of the targets that I talked about in the earliest moment of this video. We can start to see in the hair a texture evolving. We have brush strokes flowing in the direction that the hair is taking. And while I think we all appreciate that and would definitely use that in our practice, I want to mention something that I think is really important to consider when you're doing this. The value that those brush strokes take has to be suitable to the plane that they're on, which is to say, we can't take a dark value here and run it all the way from these darker sections of the hair into the lighter sections of the hair. If we do that, we're going to be disturbing the organization of form that we've made from the very first moment in this painting. This top plane here catches the light really well. As the plane shifts and begins to turn away from the light, we have a darker set of values incorporated. The point that I want to make essentially is please do not forget the concepts that you established, is to please not forget the concepts that you established when describing the form and describing the planes of the head when you start to paint the hair. If we do, we're going to run the risk of flattening out the picture in a small and subtle way that will undermine the sense of form in the entire picture. Something else that's interesting to point out in this moment is the nature of some of the downward-facing planes and the way they frame some of the lighter planes. We're all used to looking at an area like this at the top of the nose and finding high key values, finding little highlights that seem to stand out. The same thing with the chin. We're used to finding this very characteristic highlight on the chin, but in both instances, those higher key sections are relying on the value of the darker planes that surround them in order to show up. In my opinion, this is such an overlooked thing. Though the glabella is a part of the light shape, it's considerably darker than what's above and what's below it. In addition, the only reason this highlight at the top of the chin appears to be as bright as it is because of the two planes that are surrounding it from above and from below. It's these subtle distinctions in between values that make all the difference in the world when it comes to making the lightest areas appear as light as they need to. Something else I want to mention, because it's so often overlooked, is how the highlight on the chin is not the equal of the highlight on the forehead, nor the highlight on the cheekbone. If the head, as we understand it to be, is round and the light is coming from above, planes on the upper half of the face are going to catch more light than those planes on the lower half of the face. So even if the chin is part of a plane that turns a little bit upward in relationship to some of the other planes around it, it's not going to be the equal of the values up here. So let's just remember that when we're placing these highlights, when we're placing these higher key planes, and certainly when we're working on something like the ear. We want to pay a close attention to the hierarchy of value, and that means when things are less proximate to the light source and also turned a little bit more away from the light source, they're going to be just that much darker. Your assignment in this moment is to get a big picture view of the values in your painting. If you're sitting down when you're working, get up out of your chair, walk across the room away from your easel, and take a look back at the values you see in your painting. Is the forehead that you've painted truly lighter than the chin? Is the value of the ear indicating that it's more a part of the side plane of the head than the front plane? Is the light shape of the neck just as light as the light shape of the face? If so, it's highly likely that you're going to need to key those areas down in order to get the right sense of luminosity and impression of brightness out of the lightest areas. So this is going to be the final check-in before we wrap this painting up. For those of you out there intent upon painting this grisaille simply as a grisaille, this is going to be the last moment to make adjustments to what will be the final picture. For those of you that are going to be continuing on to the next phase of this project where we actually repaint this in color, well, it's still the final moment. As I like to say all the time, with oil painting, there is no time like the present. Carpe diem, seize the day, all those things. If you've been waiting to fix some small thing or make some little tiny adjustment that you think will turn the form better or make this painting a little bit more believable, now is the time to set to that task. Let's take a look at the painting I'm doing and see where that's at. Let's take a look at the painting I'm doing and see where we can make those changes. Now we have a pretty high degree of resolution everywhere in the painting now. Areas like the light shape of the neck, the ear, and the hair have all advanced up to the same level as the more focal area of the portrait. We even have an eye on the shadow side of the face, a little bit of light traveling through the iris from the highlight on the left-hand side, which, because it's kind of a full value step up from the rest of the light shape around it, stands out remarkably well and makes the eye look nice and glassy. There are some little curiosities though, like this brush stroke, right here beneath the lower eyelid. Eventually, we have to try to answer the question, what should be left in and what needs to be taken away? And while I am a minimalist at heart, I do think that there's room for brush strokes and how your hand as a painter can show up in your paintings. I think that there tends to be areas like that all around my work. So despite the refinement that I try to capture in the features, there's plenty of spaces where I feel like I can also be a little bit expressive with my brush strokes. But as I'm always preaching, it is about balance. If we have too many accents, they really cease to be accents, and it's just a whole lot of noise. So in your paintings, try to create a good balance in between refinement on one hand and a slightly rougher, more brisk application on the other hand. When you strike this balance well, I feel like it gives the painting a couple of different levels that you can appreciate it on. Because it is nice and refined, when we stand back from it across the room, we have this highly realistic picture to draw us in. And when we come up to the painting and we're looking at it on the surface, because by the way, we're painters and that's how we look at pictures, right? I'm forever at museums with my face as close to the painting as I can get it. But when we get that close, what we're looking for is brush strokes, little bits of texture, little bits of transparency, that creativity of application that makes us feel like the artist has considered every part of the representation. Both from a subject matter perspective, but also from a formal perspective. So even if you're at the moment in your painting where you're just struggling with getting a good picture on the canvas that is believable and makes you feel all right about it, I want to plant this seed here, that as you expand and explore your visual vocabulary, that you take into account all the different little things that paint can do and the different effects that can help you achieve. I also want to point out something about this area of the face. Notice, if you will, the drop off in value from the specular highlight here on the cheekbone to the value at the front plane of the cheek, where we essentially have this big fat pad that kind of runs down the front of our faces. Now, if we looked at the cheek from the side, we would see a roundness like this, leading down eventually to the chin. Of course, in front of that is the nose, and above that will be the eye socket. Pay attention to the angle that the top of the cheek is facing versus the angle that the front of the cheek is facing. The top of the cheek has a lot more in common with the angle of the forehead than it does with the angle of the front of the cheek. And so that's what we're seeing here. And it's little variations in value like that, that in the end of your painting can contribute to a much more believable result. It would be really convenient if all the changes that we needed to notice in our painting were the difference in between night and day, but oftentimes it's these very subtle and very slight variations in between shades of gray, in this case, literally, that are going to contribute to and help you create a very refined result. Your assignment in this moment is to take a look at your lightest planes. Search in the source image for where the specular highlights are, those highly reflective light spaces, and try to gauge and understand how much they stand out from the light value around them. Are they diffused and combining really well with the surface value? Or are they really standing out from it like a stark white highlight on top of a midtone? The relationship that you capture there is going to go a long way to helping convince us of the nature of the surface of the skin that they're representing. Every highlight is going to be distinct and a little bit different, both in value, but also in character. Some will have hard edges, some will have soft edges. It's up to us to make sure that that fits into a hierarchy that can compare favorably to our source image.